In the name of the one, holy, and living God. From today's gospel, teacher, don't you care? We're sinking. Then he got up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, be quiet, shut up. The wind then died down and there was a great calm. I don't know about you, but that story touches me deeply. Because our lives feel many times like a voyage over the sea at night. A small boat sailing on a huge expanse of water, rough, stormy, cold. And fear can well up in us all of a sudden, afraid and anxious. God seems asleep to our side. Trust comes hard to us at times like these. And still, and yet, we know firsthand that God rescues us from despair because we've been there. You see, Jesus wants us to develop a trust that is real and that is deep. To know Christ journeys with us, strength to cope with life's struggles, to reach out, not to pull back. To be open, to be giving, and to be loving. To make a difference in the lives of others. Transcendence, self-transcendence, change. You know, we hardly ever talk about them in church. Yet transcendence, self-transcendence, and change is our very business. We are mediators of transcendence. And now we are confronted as never before with change in us, in ourselves, in those around us, and certainly in our nation and in our world. Think about our national life. Last Sunday, some people talked to me and expressed to me their dismay, their fear, and their anger about the situation on our southern border. 2,300 children, it seems, have been separated from their parents who are seeking asylum in the U.S. and put in detention. 2,300 children. On Tuesday, Bishop Hirschfeld wrote this to us. He said, our God has little use for national boundaries or borders, especially when they are used to condone hatred, cruelty, or to limit God's mercy and love. How do we know this? Because the Bible tells us so clearly. He goes on to say, this year we are reading the Gospel of Mark. There in chapter 7, we find the compelling and disturbing story of how Jesus himself thought he would limit mercy based on ethnic and religious identity. And then even Jesus reversed himself. Once when he traveled across the border to the region of Tyre and Sidon, a foreign woman pleaded for him to exorcise a demon from her daughter. At first, Jesus refused, citing that he needed to take care of his own first. He actually changed his mind, the bishop writes, at the woman's urgent and heartfelt plea to God's mercy and love regardless of borders, and healed the girl, immediately indicating that God's love and compassion knows no bounds. And the girl was returned to her mother. Our bishop then issued us an invitation. He said, I invite you to join me in contacting your elected congressional deputation and urging the president to show more compassion at our southern border, to stop the brutal practice of separating children from their parents immediately. There are some copies of the bishop's letter on the table in the back. I don't know about you, but as a parent, I just can't wrap my head around the brutality and horror of this. So we will pray today in the prayers of the people for the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected. And St. Paul just pleaded in today's second reading, open wide your hearts. I feel this deeply in my bones, and maybe you do too. Think of the personal struggles and concerns, the turning points and experiences of loss that each of us might bring with us to this church today. Those things that nobody else knows about us. You know what needs to change in your relationships and in our world? What might transcendence, self-transcendence, and change look like? Where might they take you? What new, strange, and amazing worlds might they then open up for you? What would this war-torn, poverty-ridden, climate-change world of ours really look like if we lived as if transcendence, self-transcendence and change, was our very world? Listen to this poem. It's called An Autobiography in 5 chapters. I walk down the street and there's a deep hole in the sidewalk I fall in. I am lost, I am hopeless, it isn't my fault. It takes forever to find a way out. Chapter 2. I walk down the same street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place, but it isn't my fault. It still takes a long time to get out. Chapter 3. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it is there. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk, and I walk around it. Chapter 5, I walk down another street. Can we learn how to walk down another street? Some years ago, in 2004, I found out that I had significant blockages in 2 of my coronary arteries. It was sobering to be faced with my own mortality so directly. I remain grateful for the health-healing intervention of my doctors. It gets your attention. I was motivated to make the necessary lifestyle changes. New medications, weight loss, exercise, yoga, nutrition, acupuncture, meditation. I try now to listen to my body. Because, you know, prayer is coming to awareness, coming to an attentiveness to God who lives within us. Soon after this medical intervention, we visited our daughter, who then was living in the south of France. It was her home base for her travels for a Western Tibetan Buddhist group. At their monastery and retreat center, she introduced me to a colleague, and when he realized I was Kimberly's father, he said, "I've been praying for you." I can't begin to describe the impact that had on me. To be held in prayer by someone so far away, someone I had never met, someone from a different religious tradition, well, it was just so powerful. I knew then that I was part of the love that God weaves together. And in retirement, as I move from parish to parish among this diocese and the one to the south. I'm inspired by the dedication I see to intercessory prayer. But you know, we have some weird ideas about intercession. We think we are these kind of advanced intelligence officers for God. Because God, we know, is very busy and has so much on the plate. And, you know, we also know God is at times distracted and you know, he can miss a lot. So it's up to us, isn't it, to point out where God should invest God's very limited time. Oh, over there, we say. And please don't forget about her. And then, of course, there is that war and that suffering, that injustice, those refugees, and on and on. But it isn't that way, is it? Someone has said, don't I start by noticing something wrong in someone's need and then turn to God and ask God to do the best possible for those I'm concerned about? He said, deep reflection alters the picture. God is already in the situation of need, present and active, with those who are in want as the upholder and their fellow sufferer. God has reached out to us from that place and touched off a spark of response in us to that need. Having stimulated our caring, God then recruits our love and concern by stirring us from within to offer that love and that concern to others. The rule of the Society of St. John the Evangelist, our monastic community in Harvard Square, says this: Christ suffers with and in everyone indeed. Our intercession does not call down the divine presence to that place where we have seen the need, for the Christ who fills all things is already in that place. It is his Spirit who calls us to join him there by offering our love in intercessory prayer and action, to be used by God for healing and transformation. God weaves and knits together our concern to work for the good of the world, our prayer, and yes, our action. John Main, the founder of the World Community for Christian Meditation, once said, I suppose it would be difficult to estimate what it is people fear most, death or resurrection. But in meditation, we lose all our fear because we realize that death is death to fear, and resurrection is rising to new life. What do you fear more, death or resurrection? Because Christ sets us out on a new kind of life. And this meal we now share is a dress rehearsal for transcendence, self-transcendence, and change. A new life where peace, justice, and reconciliation are the norm, where there will be welcome, room, and food for everyone, no matter who, no matter what. As you come forward this day to receive the sacred bread and wine, be aware of that limitless reality of love. And as St. Paul said, open wide